last time we discussed, we began to discuss simulation, right? Monte Carlo simulation. And we discussed multi-hull problem, so, which is a very interesting problem, but indeed not very difficult, but very intriguing, right? So I just used that to motivate simulation. Because by simulation, people felt less confused about this problem. They gradually learned what's going on here. So then, let's think of the question, why we need simulation? And actually, I think it's it's not difficult to understand. Because usually, anyway, if you need to analyze a real-life system, then actually you may need to formulate a probability model. But this model could be a simple model, could be a more complex model, right? So if it's sufficiently simple, then maybe we can find out analytical tools to analyze that. So mathematically, if it's simple, then we may use our knowledge to analyze the output of the system. However, such a case is very rare. So as long as the system is sufficiently complicated, most of the time,
recording in progress.
So most of the time, then we can add. Most of the time, we cannot just use a mathematical model for our own purposes. So, of course, you can make the model more complex. But as a result, most of the time, the model will become intractable. Intractable means you don't have good tools, whether it's an analytical tool or computational tool. For analyzing such a system. Then, what can we do? So nowadays, thanks for the advances of computational techniques, and we have more and more powerful computers, and we have faster and faster algorithms, and so on, right? So then, we can do simulation. What is simulation? Simulation is just you just need to write a program. So in this program, you just mimic the operations of the system you're interested in. Then you just leave all the dynamics to the computer program. You don't care too much about it. In the end, you just need to analyze the output of that computer program. So the principle is, or the belief is that as long as the computer program is sufficiently complex so that it can mimic all the essential procedures within this system, then you can believe that the output should also be close to the real output from that system. So, in some sense, you just use this computer program as a proxy or approximation or just a model. But that model would be more complex than typical mathematical models. So then, so in this way, actually, in many cases, we can model the real system as faithfully as possible. And as I said, what we really need to do is just to analyze the output, right? So that's why we need some simulation. But then maybe let me talk a little bit about the history of Monte Carlo simulation. If you check the Wikipedia, the definition of Monte Carlo methods actually is like this. They refer to a broad class of computational algorithms that rely on repeated random sampling to obtain numerical results. So, what does it mean? Actually, if just let me explain the moral of Monte Carlo methods, I would say it's just a strong law of large numbers. So, the moral of Monte Carlo methods is just like you create a lot of samples. And we know that by the strong law of large numbers, the sample mean will converge to the expected value, right? So then Monte Carlo methods is just to transform the phenomena or some output you're interested into some expected value. Then by generating a lot of samples, then you just use the sample mean to approximate that expected value. So that's the basic principle that Monte Carlo simulation relies upon. And maybe let me talk a little bit about some historical remark about Monte Carlo methods. So it was first developed by Stanislaw Ulam, who was a physicist. So he's not a mathematician. He's not even a probabilist. He was a physicist. So he developed this type of methods in 1930s when he was working at the Los Alamos National Labs. So at the time, he's studying nuclear weapons. So because you know that he's a physicist, so when he studied nuclear weapons, he needed to do a lot of computation about reactions. So then particularly, you need to do a lot of integral. So he's given a very, very complicated function. Then he may need to evaluate the integral of this function. So it doesn't sound like a very difficult job, but indeed, it could be very, very difficult. So for example, we know that we just learned normal distribution, right? So the PDF of a normal distribution is just an exponential function. But we know that if we wish to evaluate the integral of that function, actually there's no closed form solution for that. So in this case, you must find out ways to evaluate that integral numerically. But how can we do that? So in 1940s, they didn't really have very good tools. At that time, they don't even have very powerful computers, right? So then it's Ulam. He just gives a very clever idea to randomly generate numbers. And by taking the sample mean of certain random numbers, then he used that to approximate the integral you would be interested in. So later, so you will see how to do that. And that's the very first use of this type of method. So for doing integral. And of course, so by the convention, because this type of method was invented by Ulam, so people should call it Ulam's method or whatever, right? But actually, why it is called Monte Carlo method? Because this was suggested by another scientist, so whose name was Nicholas Matriopoulos. Matriopoulos was a very famous statistician. So I think maybe some of you know the very, very, very famous algorithm called Matriopoulos-Hastie. So that this is that Matriopoulos. And he suggests that we may call it another name rather than Ulam's method. Why is it so? If it's just Ulam's method, people just know that it's invented by you, but they don't understand what his method is about, right? And so Nesimochopoulos learned that Ulam actually had an uncle who was a gambler. So you know that gamblers, they are the very first people who are interested in probability. The development of probability theory so was first done by gamblers because they need to understand so the what's going on, what's the basic principles underlying all those games, right? So in this case, then this Metropolis suggests that we may call this method Monte Carlo method. Why it is called Monte Carlo? Because we know that Monte Carlo is a city of gambling. A lot of casinos there. To call this method Monte Carlo method, then people can easily connect to this method with probability techniques, sampling, so taking average, whatever, right? So that's why this type of method is called Monte Carlo. Then let's, so this is a, so next let's see a very simple example. Through this example, you may experience some flavor of Monte Carlo methods. So in this example, we will use a randomized method to calculate the value of pi. Right? So it's a it sounds very interesting, right? Because we know that pi is just a constant. How can we design a random experiment by which we can calculate for this this number, right? So this one is not actually it's very simple. So let me explain. So here, so suppose we have two independent uniform random variables. We call them X and Y. And both of them are uniformly distributed between -1 and 1, right? So from this, you can see that because they're uniform, so then it's, the density of each one is just 1/2, right? Over the interval from -1 to 1, the density would be 1/2. PDF would be 1/2. Then, so that's a they're two independent random variables, right? So let's consider their joint probability density function. So this is a longest F. Because they're independent, actually, so the joint PDF is just the product of their marginal PDFs, right? So because within the interval, the PDF of each guy is just 1/2, so the joint PDF would be 1/2 times 1/2. Which is 1/4, right? So when X and Y between -1 and 1, then the density, the joint density is 1/4. So because here we consider a pair of random variables, so indeed, so this pair should take values within this square, right? So what is this square? So this square is it has the 4 points of this square is just -1, -1, -1, -1, and so on, right? If this black dot is the origin, then you see, so these are the coordinates of this square. It's just a 2 by 2 square. And the pair of random variables x and y would take values within this wire. So let's draw a circle within this wire. So the radius of the circle is equal to 1, right? So that's that is the circle here. We know that if we randomly pick up a point within this wire, so if x squared plus y squared less than 1, so which means that that point must be within this wire, right? If x squared plus y squared bigger than 1, then it's still within the square, but I'm sorry, so it's but outside the circle. If x squared plus y squared less than 1, then it must be within the circle, right? So then, this is very easy to understand. So next, so let's think of the question like this. What is the probability that this pair of random, this pair of random variables satisfy x squared plus y squared less than 1? So let's think of what is this probability, right? As I said, if x squared plus y squared means so this pair, this random pair, should be within the circle, right? And if it is within the circle, what is this random square? As I said, it's just a pair of independent uniform random variables, right? So then the probability, because it's a uniform, actually the probability that it is it's in anywhere within this circle should be even. So this probability, so this random pair is within the circle, should just be the area of the circle over the area of the square, right? So we know that this circle has a radius 1. So the area of that is just pi times the square of the radius, which is pi, right? So then from this, we can see, because the area of the square is 4, so this probability would just be the area of the circle over the area of the square, so which is the pi over 4. So then, how to calculate pi, right? But then you see, now we can rely on the strong law of large numbers. So we just argued that the probability that if we randomly select a point according to that joint distribution, then the probability that it's within this circle is pi over 4, right? Probability. What is probability? Probability is limiting relative frequency, right? So if we generate a lot of random points according to that joint uniform distribution, we generate a lot of them and calculate the relative frequency of any many points, then that relative frequency should be close to that probability, right? So that's the idea. So in this way, maybe you would just use computer to generate, say, 10,000, 100,000 points, random points. Each point just follow the joint uniform distribution. And among those points, we just count how many of them are within that circle. How to tell that? We just test whether x squared plus y squared less than 1. If it is less than 1, then it's within the circle. Otherwise, it's outside the circle. Then we calculate what is the relative frequency that the points within a circle. Then, in the end, that relative frequency should converge to pi over 4. So then, we can use this 4 times that relative frequency to approximate pi. if the number of points are sufficiently large. So this approximation should be good. Why is so? Because we have strong law of large numbers, right? So that's the idea. And actually, it's just a, I just draw this picture. So using MATLAB, if a point happens to be within the circle, so which means that x squared plus y squared less than 1, then I just color that point blue. Otherwise, I color that red. So then I just run it many, many times. So then I have this picture. So then essentially, we just need to count how many blue points are there and how many points total. What is the number of total points, right? Total number of points. Then we calculate the frequency, relative frequency. So maybe we can run a simulation. Here, I wrote a very simple program for that. So here, see this program, can I see it clearly? Here, I will generate 20,000 points. And we use this variable, NIN. So it is just a counter. It's a counter for the number of points within a circle. So then in this program, I just each time I will generate a random number x and a random number y. So recall that this command rnid will generate a uniform random number between 0 and 1. So then, 2 times a random number between 0 and 1 will become a uniform random number between 0 and 1. Then, if we remove 1 from this guy, it will become a uniform random number between minus 1 and 1. Right? So in this way, I generate x and generate y. And next, I test whether x squared plus y squared less than 1. If it's less than 1, means so this random pair is within the circle. If it's within the circle, then the counter should be increased by 1, right? And then we just do this loop, and we just generate 20,000 points. And in the end, so we just we need to know is NIN is the number of points within the circle. So NIN over N would be the relative frequency that points within the circle. 4 times that should be approximate of pi, approximation of pi, right? So then, let's run it. So see, the result here is the estimate of pi is 3.138. It's not very, very close to pi, but it's still okay, right? Because we didn't run a lot of, so the points, we have only 20,000 points. If we have more points, it would be more accurate. Maybe let me run it again. So this time, you see a different number, but you see it's still around pi. Sometimes it's smaller, sometimes it's bigger, greater than pi, right? So I think I have posted that program on Canvas. If you wish to have a more accurate estimation. Okay, you can change this number. But we need more time to run it. So I will just leave it to you. So this is a how to estimate pi. So next, let's discuss how to use this Monte Carlo method to evaluate an integral, right? So that's what Ulam did 80 years ago, right? So in this example, we use this g for an arbitrary function. We wish to evaluate the integral of this function from 0 to 1. Right. So how to calculate this? So see, this one will be very simple. So here, maybe we use this u, this capital U, for a uniform random variable over 0 and 1. So uniform over 0 and 1. And later you will see that this type of random variables would be extremely important in simulation because it's a building block of every other random variables. So from now on, we just call it standard uniform. Standard means it takes a value from 0 to 1, right? Standard uniform. This U is standard uniform. Then we know that because it's uniform, because it's from 0 to 1, so the PDF of that over that interval is just equal to 1, right? The length of that interval is 1, so it's 1 over 1, which is 1. And outside that interval is 0. The PDF is 0. So let's think of what is the expected value of g of u. So again, this u is the standard uniform random variable. So how do we evaluate this? Because this u is a continuous random variable, right? To evaluate this, we know that I just need to follow this formula. Why is this formula? Because we need to take an integral over the entire real line from minus infinity to infinity. However, only within the interval from 0 to 1, the density is not 0, right? So we don't have to consider other parts of the real line. We only need to consider this part. And over this interval, the density of that is simply equal to 1, right? So how to calculate this expected value? At each point, we need to evaluate the value of this function, which is this g of x, and times the probability density. What is the probability density? Which is 1 here, right? So you see, expect the value of g of u is simply equal to this one, which is the integral we wish to calculate, right? So you can see that actually the theta just equal to this expected value of g of u. So then the question is how to calculate this one, right? Then the idea is to use Stroll law of large numbers. How did we do? So each time we will generate a standard uniform random number. So maybe we can generate n such guys. So we call them u1, u2, up to un. This n should be a large number. 10,000, 100,000, something like that, right? So then we know that. So then each g, this g is a function here, right? G of u, u1, g of u1, g of u2. And because these u1 up to un are id standard uniform, so then the g of them are also id, and they should have the same each of them should have the same expected value theta, right? So then by the strong law of large numbers, if we calculate the sample mean of them, so which is this one, right? We add them together and divide them by n, which is a sample mean. Strong law of large numbers tells us that so the sample mean should converge to the expected value of this guy. So it should be equal to this, right? So then that's the idea of Monte Carlo simulation. What we need to do is just like this. We generate a lot of standard uniform random numbers. And each random number will take whatever value, right? And at this value, we evaluate the function g at this value. And then we have n such g of such these values. We add them, those numbers together, take the sample mean. And when n is large, so this one should be close to theta, to this integral, right? So in this way, you see that so by using this Monte Carlo method, you don't need to know how to do integration. You don't need to understand what is the antiderivative or whatever. As long as you have the expression of this function g, as long as you can evaluate the value of this function at any given value, then you can do this integral, right? So that's the idea of a Monte Carlo simulation for an integral. So this one, I think it's pretty simple, but I think it's very clever, simple and clever. Maybe let's check a very simple example. Suppose that we wish to evaluate so this integral. Integral from 0 to 1 of x to the power 4. So we wish to evaluate what is that. So can you see what is the value of this integral? What is that? It should be 1, 2, right? So because if we take integral of x4, then we have 1 over 5 times x to the power 5. Then we evaluate them at 0 and 1. And 0 is 0 and 1 is 0.2. 0.2 minus 0 is 0.2, right? So this one is pretty simple. So of course, and this one is very simple, but I wish to use this very simple example to illustrate how to do the integration by using the Monte Carlo method. We just follow this idea, right? So then we just generate a lot of standard uniform random numbers. And for each random number, uk, we just evaluate the value of uk to the power 4. Add them together, take the sample average, and this thing, according to the strong law of large numbers, should be close to 0.2, right? So let's check whether this is true. So let's see this. So this is the program for evaluating the previous integral. So here we will evaluate, we will generate 100,000 standard uniform random numbers. So and this number. And this sum is used to record the sum of all those guys. And because in the end we need to take the sample mean, for the sample mean we need to calculate the sum of them first. So let's generate such points. Each time this U is just a standard uniform, right? And we just sum up of U to the power 4, right? And after the loop, we take the sample mean. Let's see. You see, the result is not exactly 0.2, but close to that, right? If we run it again, so this time, a bit different from the previous value, but because this run each time would be different. So this time is slightly bigger than 0.2. You see all around 0.2. Mm-hmm. And then it's this example. So next, let's see. Let's do a little bit of extension of the for that integral. So this time, we wish to evaluate the integral like this. So this time, we just wish to evaluate the integral from the arbitrary A to B. So it is not simply from 0 to 1, but it's from A to B. So how can we do that? Actually, you may think that so it would be the same as the previous one, right? Previously, we just consider integral from 0 to 1, but it's this time from A to B, what we really need to do is just to generate uniform random variables over the interval from A to B, right? Then we just do whatever we did just now. But actually, that's not the standard way. Why I said so? Because the standard uniform will be standard phase. So later you will see we will generate all kinds of random variables using standard uniforms. So because of this, if we wish to evaluate such a random variable, integral, then it would be great if we can use a standard uniform, not an arbitrary random variable that follow whatever distribution. As long as we can use standard uniform random numbers, we should use that. So then the question is how to evaluate such an integral by using standard uniform random numbers. Right? So how can we do that? So let's see. So here we wish to evaluate this, right? So then our purpose is to use standard uniform random numbers to evaluate this integral by Monte Carlo method, right? So then, essentially, what we really need to do is to transform this integral into an integral from 0 to 1 with respect to a certain function, right? Because if we change the lower limit and upper limit of this definite integral, so then the function should also be changed accordingly, right? If this integral is just from 0 to 1, then of course we can use what we discussed just now to So this one is simply equal to the expected value of h of u. So this u is the standard. So this u is the standard uniform univariable, right? The next step is to use Monte Carlo, so which means generate a lot of random numbers and evaluate at this function and take the sample, right? So that's the basic idea. So you can see, essentially, is, what we really need to do is to find out what is this h, right? And how to do that? Because this one is pretty simple. We can just do that through a linear transformation. How to do this linear transform? So first, maybe we can do that through two steps. So first, we can transform the integral from a to b to integral from 0 to b minus a. So this step should be simple because we just need to shift the function a little bit, right? Shift it. And then from 0 to b minus a, we need to make some transformation to make it from 0 to 1. Then we need to do scaling, right? So originally from 0 to b minus a, then we just need to expand it or squeeze it to make it from 0 to 1. So that's the idea. How to do that? It's I think it's pretty standard. So the first step would be this step. In this step, what we need to do is just maybe we can, because we need to make we need to shift the function. So then, how to do that? Then we may use this as z for x minus a, right? Because this interval from a to b will be changed from 0 to b minus a. So definitely, each one should be shifted by a. Then if this z is x minus a, then of course this x would be z plus a. And by the standard calculus techniques, we know that this actually dx is equal to dz, right? So then from here, let's see. Originally, we have this integral, right? Then we wish to use z instead. Because this x is equal to z plus a, so then the function should be changed into that part, g of z plus a. Because we use z instead, then the upper limit and the lower limit should be changed accordingly. Right? Originally, x is from a to b, because this z is x minus a, so z is from 0 to b minus a, right? And then this dx is equal to this dz. So that's the very first step. In the next step, we need to squeeze the interval from 0 to b minus a into 0 to 1, right? How can we do that? We need to squeeze z accordingly. Right, when we define this y to be z over b minus a. Z over b minus a. So then this z should be equal to b minus a times y. Right? Why bother to do this? Because we need to know what is dz. Dz is, according to this, dz is equal to b minus a times dy. Right? Then let's see. So this is what we have now, right? Because we wish to use y to replace z. So because y is equal to z over b minus a, when z is equal to 0, y is equal to 0. When z is equal to b minus a, y is equal to 1, right? So then this g of z plus a will become this g of b minus a times y plus a, b because of the Z and they go to this guy, right? And here, what is this DZ? This DZ, as we just argued, is equal to B minus A times DY, right? So now we have this expression. So this thing, so we take the integral for this thing from 0 to 1, right? So then you see that we can call this guy H of Y. This is the function we wish to have. Then, what is this? Now, what do we have is this integral actually should be equal to expected value of h of u. What is h? H is this guy, as I said, so it is equal to this one. Right? Then, how to evaluate this? Again, each time we generate a standard uniform random number and plug in to the function h to find the value of that. So what is h? It's just here, right? And that's the way when we do this integral. So, in that example, so we wish to evaluate an integral like this. So this time, the definite integral is from 0 to infinity. So from A to B, both A and B are finite. So we can just do what we did just now, right? But this time, the upper limit is infinite. And how to squeeze an infinite interval into a finite one from 0 to 1. So that's, it may need some tricks, right? So let's think of this time. So this time, we wish to evaluate this integral. This integral from 0 to infinity, right? And again, we wish to do the same thing. We wish to transform this integral into a definite integral from 0 to 1 with respect to another function h, right? So again, the question is, given this g, how to find out the expression of h? So, how do we do that? So we know that this time we need to transform such a definite integral into such a definite integral, right? What can we do? So there is a, of course, because on the left-hand side, this one is an infinite integral. A simple linear transform would not work. By a standard linear transform, so infinite thing should still be infinite thing, right? So which means that we need to do some nonlinear stuff. How do we do that? So the idea is that, so we know that this one is troublesome, right? So this infinity is troublesome. But if you observe that, you can see that this the reciprocal of infinity, actually, it's zero. 1 over infinity, you can take it as 0, right? So, which means that actually, so this limit corresponds to this one, right? And if you realize this, then you may need to find a way to correspond this guy 1 into this 0, right? How can we do that? It would be a standard trick. So this time we just take y is equal to 1 over x plus 1. So why we need to do this? So let's check. If y is taken to be that, when x is 0, which means that this x takes this lower limit, then y is 1 over 0 plus 1, which is 1, right, here. And when x is infinity, so which is the upper limit, right, what is this y? Y is 1 over infinity plus 1, still infinity, so it's is 0, which is here, right? So then, you see, if we do this on such a transform, then it's okay. And so this interval will become this interval. So now, let's see what we need to do. Here, because we use this y to be 1 over x plus 1, of course, we need to do a little bit of algebra to find out the relationship between x and y, right? If y is equal to this, then, of course, so this denominator times y should be equal to 1, so which is this part, right? And from this, then we can derive the expression for x in terms of y. So 1 minus y over y, so which is this guy. This is the expression of x. And it would be more convenient for us to write it like this. So inverse of y minus 1, right? Why is so? Because if we write it in this way, it's easy to take the derivative x time. So based on this expression, so then we can see that this dx should be the derivative of this guy times dy, right? What is the derivative of this guy? Derivative of this guy should be minus 1 times y to the power minus 2. So this 1 times dy, right? So this is the relationship between dx and dy. So now let's do the integral. So this is the integral we wish to evaluate, right? And according to the according to this transformation, so when x is equal to 0, y is equal to 1. When x is equal to infinity, y is equal to 0, right? So accordingly, so if this integral should look like this. So then, what is this x? X is equal to this guy. So we put it here, right? What is dx? Dx is equal to this one. Then we put it here, right? And, but of course, you see that this is the integral, the upper limit, the lower limit. The upper limit is smaller than the lower limit. It is not standard way, right? So we need to switch. We need to switch the limit. If we switch the limit, the value will become negative, right? It'll be canceled out. If we take, if we switch the limit, so this minus sign will be gone, right? So then from this part, we have this part. So now we have a definite integral from 0 to 1 with respect to a function of y. Then you see that this one, this function should be this h of y, what we wish to have, right? And then you see we can have this one, then actually we just follow what we discussed. Because we already have the expression of this function h, which is plugging the standard uniform random variable into that. So this one should be equal to the expected value of this expression, right? How to evaluate this expected value? Again, using the Monte Carlo method, we just generate a lot of standard uniform random numbers, and we'll take the sample mean to approximate that. And that's that's how to how to calculate so such a such an integral from 0 to infinity. Okay. So here, let's see a simple example. So we wish to use Monte Carlo method to evaluate this integral. So integral from 0 to infinity, e to the power minus x. So can I see what is the value of this? Can I see that? Actually, you can see that in this way. So this is an exponential function, right? What is an exponential function? It is also a PDF of an exponential and normal, right? PDF. What is the PDF of an exponential distribution? It's a lambda times e to the power minus lambda x, right? So if I take lambda is equal to 1, it should be this guy, right? So you see that it is just a exponential PDF, right? You take an integral from 0 to infinity of exponential PDF, what should it have? It's 1, right? Integral of the PDF must be 1, because probability, right? So then, how do you evaluate this? Actually, according to this expression, so this h should take this 4. You just check that according to this. It takes this 4. H is like this. And then the simulation, what we need to do is just to generate random numbers, evaluate that using h, sample mean, and so on, right? So let's check. So this is the program for that. Actually, so maybe you can go back to check that the ideas will be just the same as the previous one, and you can check that this is the expression we just discussed, right? So this one in this program will just generate 100,000 points and take the sample mean. So again, so this sample mean is supposed to be close to 1, right, as we discussed just now. Let's check that. So we see it's very close to 1.9977 something. Do it again. So this time slightly bigger than 1. This is a simulation for integral. So from the previous discussion, you can see that if we wish to do some Monte Carlo simulation, where we wish to use the Monte Carlo method to compute something, then the very first step is to find a way to generate random numbers, right? If you cannot generate random numbers, then how, when we have discussed, would not make any sense, right? So, and based on what we discussed just now, it would be will prefer us to generate standard uniform random numbers, right? So usually when we talk about random numbers, it just means standard uniform. It just means the value of a random variable uniformly distributed between 0 and 1. When we talk about random numbers, 99% of time, it means this thing, right? Then the question is how to generate such random numbers. So, of course, we can do something, you know, intrinsically random. So, for example, we flip a coin, we flip a die, and something like this, right? Of course, you know that it's not efficient. If we just produce randomness manually, then if I wish to evaluate that integral using 100,000 random numbers, then it's not easy, right? Of course, we need to generate those random numbers by using computers, because computers are good at repeated jobs. If you ask them to do this for 10,000 times, then no complaints, right? So, however, if you think of this a bit more, you may realize that there could be some intrinsic issue here. Why is that so? Because let's first think of how a computer works. So, a computer is essentially, you wish to use a computer to do something, you need to let it know a series of commands, so which is called a program, right? A series of commands, so each command, maybe you just tell the CPU, add this number with this number, you put them together. And maybe next command is like, if this condition is satisfied, then we do A, otherwise we do B, something like this, right? However, you realize that each command is just a deterministic thing. You just tell the CPU to do this, to do that, right? No randomness. But our job is to produce random numbers. Essentially, there should be random mechanism involved in order to produce true randomness, right? However, for a computer, you just did whatever you told it to do, right? No randomness at all. So because of this, because of the nature of the computers, actually, the numbers produced by computers are not really random. That's so-called pseudo-random numbers. Pseudo means fake, right? Pseudo-random means deterministic. So, again, as I mentioned that, we have a lot of numbers, but they're fake ones. They're not truly produced by some random mechanism. It's produced by a deterministic mechanism. Just behave like true random numbers, but they're fake ones, right? So the question then, you may ask me the question, is there any issue about this? I need random numbers, but give me fake ones. So it sounds troublesome, right? So, most of the time it's okay. Why is that so? Maybe we can think of that in this way. If I'm given a bunch of numbers, said to be random numbers, how can I tell whether it's produced by a truly random mechanism or just by some deterministic computer program? How can I check that? So you may say that maybe we can use some statistical methods to check whether so those numbers appear to follow so standard uniform distribution, whether they appear to be independent of each other, right? Then as long as it can pass certain so well-defined statistical tests, then most of the time, whether it's truly random or pseudo-random, it may not matter, right? So then, I think that's the point. Actually, when we talk about random numbers, they're not truly random. They're just pseudo-random numbers. But the behavior of them would be nice in the sense that, so if you wish to test by all known statistical methods about independence, about distribution, or whatever, they appear to be good, then it's fine, right? So that's the idea of a pseudo-random number generator. So I think we can have a minute break. Okay, let's move on. So this is the idea about pseudo-random numbers. So then the question is how to produce pseudo-random numbers. There are a lot of ways. And actually the most, the simplest way is the so-called linear congruential generator. So what is that? It is just a pretty simple idea. So this generator produces pseudo random numbers by a recursive procedure according to so this formula. So let's see, what is this? This formula actually has three parameters. So it's kind of sad, it's a recursive way. When you design this generator, then you need to design three parameters. We call it A, C, and M. All those A, C, M are the negative integers. So then, what does this mean? So it means that, so first, you begin with N equals to 1. So when you consider N equals to 1, you generate the first random number. The first number is produced in this way. When N is equal to 1, so of course this X sub N minus 1 would be X0, right? X0 should also be given. But usually this X0 is the initial value. This initial value is not really a parameter. So usually you can choose that freely. It can be any integer. So you only need to design A and C and M. So this X0 is called the seed. So we wish to know what is this X1. So first you use A times X0 plus C. Because both A, X0, and C are integers, then you have a positive, you have a negative integer, right? The next thing you need to do is to do a so-called modulo operation. So this guy, within the parentheses, it's a negative integer, right? This integer will be divided by M. This M is another positive integer. This guy divided by M, the remainder of that is given to this XM. So the N is equal to 1, so the remainder is given to X1. So integer divided by integer, you have a quotient plus a remainder. The remainder is set to be the value of this accent. You do that recursively. From x0, you determine x1. And you will use x1 to determine x2, and so on. So this is the so-called linear congruential generator. Then you have a bunch of numbers, x0, x1, x2, and so on, right? Because each one is just a remainder of this modular operation. It's a remainder, which means that so each x must be less than this m, right? It can be 0, 1, up to m minus 1. So because of this, if we think of this value, xn over m, so this value must be a number between 0 and 1. Then this un will be taken as a random number. So this, maybe let me give you an example so that you can understand this in a clearer way. So maybe let's, before we check the example, maybe let's check the terminology. So again, as I said, the initial value is called the seed. And this A is called multiplier. C is called increment. And M is called modulus. So, and this thing is called the linear congruential generator. Let's check this example. This is a pretty simple example, and it is a toy example. It's not practical. It's not used. So this example is not useful. And this that example only for you to understand the procedure. So here, the generator is designed to be this. So you see that the multiplier is 2, increment is 1, and the modulus is 7. So suppose that a seed is given. Seed means the initial value, right? X0 is equal to 3. So then let's determine each x1, x2, and so on, right? So first, we know that x0 is 3. Then we just plug in 3 into this expression. So then it becomes 2 times 3 plus 1 modulo 7. So what does it mean? So first, we need to calculate the expression within the parentheses. 2 times 3 plus 1, which would be equal to 7, right? 7 divided by 7 is equal to 1. The remainder is 0. 7 divided by 7 is equal to 1. Remainder is 0. The remainder is said to be the value of x1. So x1 is equal to the remainder. Remainder is 0, right? And then what is the random number? Random number is u1, which should be x1 over m. So x1 over 7, 0 over 7, which is 0. So we know what is x1. So next, let's see what is x2. So again, we need to use this generator. Then to determine the value of x2, we need to use the value of x1. What is x1? X1 is 0, right? So 2 times 0 plus 1, which is 1. 1 divided by 7, which is equal to 0. Remainder is 1. So this remainder is said to be x2. So x2 divided by the modulus, which is 7. So then it's 1 over 7 is the value of u2. So let's see x3. X3 should be determined by the value of x2. What is x2? X2 is 1. X2 is here, right? 2 times x2 plus 1, which is equal to 3. 3 divided by 7, which is equal to 0. The remainder is 3.
So this 3 is set to be x3. U3 is 3 over 7. Right? Then we do the same thing. For x4, we plug in x3 here. X3 is equal to 3, so within the parentheses, it's 2 times 3 plus 1, which is equal to 7. 7 divided by 7 is equal to 1. The remainder is 0. So you see x4 is equal to 0. U4 is equal to 0. Right? So here, you can see that x1 actually is equal to x4. But this is because x0 is equal to x3, right? Because it is determined by such a generator. Once you see a repeated value, then all below will be the same, will repeat, right? So from 3, the next value must be 0, right? And then as long as you see 3 again, next one will be 0. So you can see that actually by using this linear congruential generator with initial value 3, then the value must be 301, 301, 301, and so on. Right? So this is how the linear congruential generator works. It just follows this recursive procedure. Each time you calculate a value, divided by the modulus. So you just need to send the remainder to the next value, which is xn, right? The random number is xn over the modulus. So again, because each xn is just a remainder, so it could take value from 0 up to m minus 1. Because of this, so each x over m, it cannot be bigger than 1. It must be something between 0 and 1. So this u n will serve as the value of a random number. So that's the idea. So it's pretty simple. But again, as I said, so this is I just used this example to illustrate how the linear congruential generator works. So definitely, so this is not a good generator. Because if you wish to use this generator, you can see that you can only have 3 different values. So which is 3 over 7, 0, and 1 over 7. Right? If you wish to use this as a pseudo random number, it doesn't seem to follow a uniform distribution over 0 to 1, right? Because it only takes 3 different values. It's baby stuff, right? So, of course, from this example, you know how the generator works, but you also know that an arbitrary generator may not be good, right? If we wish to design a good generator, so of course, you need to take a lot of different values. And also, it should behave like a standard uniform random variable. And if we take different values, so they should appear to be independent. If you have just 3 values, then no way it will satisfy any of the above requirement, right? So, from this, actually, you can see that because according to the procedure, as I said, each xn can only take 1 of 0 up to m minus 1, right? So then after some finite number, which is at most m of generated values, so the sequence must repeat itself, right? As long as you see the same number as some previous number, then the same pattern will repeat, right? So in this way, actually, so there's a definition related to that, which is called a period,
the period of a random number generator is the number of values that can be produced before the exact sequence of values repeats. And as I said, so in this example, you see that it would just appear 013, 013, and so on, right? So what is the period of this sequence? It should be 3, right? So after 3 numbers, it will repeat. So this is the period of this generator. So again, it's the number of values that can be produced before the exact sequence repeats, right? So this one is 3. And also, it comes to the question that not every generator would be great. Then how can we design A, C, M? A is a multiplier, C is increment, M is a modulus. How can we choose those 3 parameters so that the generator should be a good one, right? So then we need to be very clear. So what kind of generator would be regarded as a good one? So it should, at least it should satisfy 2 conditions. So the first one is that the resultant sequence. So again, as we discussed, the sequence after a certain amount of time it will repeat, right? So the sequence should have the appearance of being a sequence of the independent uniform random variables. Which means that so this one, the previous one takes whatever value, the next one could be close, could be far away from that one, right? So it should, at least it should look like the value of the previous one should have nothing, should have no influence on the next one. So that's a independence, right? And also the number of variables that can generate before repetition begins should be large. So which means that so the period of the sequence should be a large number. Again, if the sequence can only generate 3 different values, definitely we cannot use that as a standard uniform random number, right? So which means that this M must be a big number. Only if M is big, we can have different numbers. But of course, if the parameters are not correct, the parameters are not good, even if M is good, even if M is large, the period could still be small. But sometimes it could be large, right? So here, why is so? Because the period is at most M. It cannot be bigger than M. So these are 2 requirements that a good linear convergential generator should satisfy. And also there's another concern about efficiency. So what is that? So usually this pseudo random number will be generated by a computer, right? Of course, we wish the computer to calculate so this thing quickly, right? How can we get this x in from a given x sub n minus 1 in a very fast way? So that's the question. Usually, we know that for the CPU, if we wish to do addition, it can be very fast. So if we do multiplication, not so fast. If we wish to do division, of course, not so fast, right? But because we know that in computers, all numbers will take the form of a series of binary bits, right? Each number should be represented as a series of memory bits there. If this M, this modulus, is taken to be the power of 2, so for example, it's taken to be 2 to the power 32. When we do the division, when we wish to take the remainder, what do we need to do? We just need to keep the last 31 bits of the number, right? Because this M is a power of 2. When we do division, we just shift. We just shift the bits. And only the last few bits need to be kept. So which is the remainder? In this way, you can see that when we take M to be the power of 2, then division can be done in a very, very efficient way, right? So especially, we know that in computers, so it'll be even more efficient if, so this M taken to be power of exact word size. So nowadays, most computers, the word size of most computers is just 64 bits, right? So decades ago, we still have a lot of computers that is 32 bits. So most of time, we just take M is equal to either 2 to the power 32 or 2 to the power 64. Why we need to do so? Because that's the most efficient way to take the remainder. We just shape the number by whole word, right? And the remainder is there. So that's the very, very efficient way for division. And actually, how to design a good random number generator. So, as I said, M can be taken either for this number or that number. What will be a good C, good A, good C? Sometimes you need to search. So, you really need to search a lot of different values. And for this C, for this pair of A and C, then you have a bunch of numbers generated. You do some tests to see whether they appear to be good, right? So in this example, I give you the parameters from Visual C++. So it is a pretty old version. In that version, A is taken to be that value, C is that value. Okay. So this is the linear congruential generator. And I would say that you must know how to do this. How to generate random numbers. So using this linear congruential generator. Because in the final exam, actually because we don't pass coding. So there are not a lot of things I can test for the simulation part. Thankfully, this linear congruential generator is an easy topic for me to design questions, right? So you need to understand, so what's going on here? So what is that procedure? If I give you a seed, you need to produce a sequence of random numbers. And you need to identify what will be the period of that, and so on. So this is how we generate standard uniform random numbers. Then the next question is, okay, we know, so standard uniform is just pseudo random numbers generated by linear congruential generators. So then, if I need other types of random variables, what should I do, right? Actually, the idea is pretty straightforward. So let's think of a random variable. So if we have a random variable, we call it maybe U, right? It will follow whatever distribution. Then we know that a function of a random variable will still be a random variable, right? If we call this function H, which means that this H of U will be another random variable. Of course, depending on what form this H would take, this H of U would take a different distribution, right? So what is this U? This U would be standard uniform. Then we need to design this H. When this H take different forms, then this H of U will take a different distribution. So that's the idea, how we generate a random variable that follows other distributions. So again, the principle is, so first, we find out a very efficient, fast way to generate standard uniform random numbers. Then we design a function H. So this H is follow whatever form, then this H of U will take a different distribution. So that's the idea of generating a random variable that follows an arbitrary distribution. So maybe let's think of a very simple example. So suppose this X is a Bernoulli random variable. So let's recall what is a Bernoulli random variable. Bernoulli only takes two different values, either 1 or 0. With probability P, it takes 1. With probability 1 minus P, it takes 0. So now let's see how to generate a Bernoulli random variable using standard uniform. So let's see how to do this. So again, we already know that how to generate standard uniform. So we use this uniform 01 for standard uniform distribution. We know how to do that, right? Just a linear congruential generator. Then we wish to find a function H. So this H of U, which is called X, will follow a desired distribution, right? So for example, if this X is required to follow a Bernoulli distribution, then what we can do? So first, we know that Bernoulli is distribution like this. It takes 1 with probability P, and takes 0 with probability 1 minus P, right? How can we generate this one? So the idea is pretty straightforward, right? So first, let's think of an interval from 0 to 1. So why do we need to think of an interval from 0 to 1? Because a standard uniform will take values, so we need this interval, right? The interval from 0 to 1, then let's think of the point P, so which is the probability that the Bernoulli random variable takes value 1, right? So if this point is P, then the length from 0 to P would be P. The length from P to 1 would be 1 minus P, right? So we know that standard uniform takes values within this interval, right? Then, because it's a uniform, the probability that it takes a value within the first interval, which is from 0 to p, would have probability p, right? So why is so? Maybe we can do some algebra. So the probability that it takes a value from 0 to p, what is that? It is simply the integral of this PDF. The PDF is 1 because it's standard uniform, right? Over this interval. So, of course, it is equal to p. Then, what is the probability that so the standard uniform takes a value from p to 1? For the same reason, we just need to calculate this integral, which is 1 minus p, right? So, again, now we know that because this u is standard uniform, it takes values within this interval with probability p and with this interval with probability 1 minus p. Then what do we need to do? We just design the random variable x like this. If this u takes the values within the first interval, we let it take value 1. If it takes a value between p and 1, which is the second interval, we let it take value 0, right? So this is that's the way we define this random variable x. So we can check that in this way, this x must follow Bernoulli distribution. Why is so? Because if we think what is the probability that x takes 1, according to this definition, x takes 1 when u takes the value between 0 and p. So, as we argued here, u takes the value between 0 and p with probability p. Right? So, you see, in this way, this x takes 1 with probability p. And for the same reason, when it takes value 0, which means that u must take a value between p and 1, which has probability 1 minus p. Right? So that's how we design this Bernoulli random variable. Simply like this. And we can generalize this idea to generate an arbitrary discrete random variable. Again, what is a discrete random variable? So this random variable can take at most countably many different values, right? So because there's countably many, we just need to list each of them. What will be the probability that it takes x0, it takes x1, and so on, right? So that's a PMF. So then, how can we generate such a random variable using standard uniform random numbers? So for our convenience, maybe let's assume that this random variable, this discrete random variable x, can take values x0, x1, and so on, and x0 less than x1 less than x2. And so on, right? Let's assume this. Then the probability that it takes xj is equal to pj. So let's see, how can we generate such a random variable? So here, so this time, again, we know that so this u standard uniform, and this x is discrete random variable. It takes value xi with probability pi, right? And also, we assume that x0 less than x1 less than x2, and so on, right? And as I said, we just need to generalize the idea we just discussed for Bernoulli distribution, Bernoulli random variables. So for Bernoulli, we only need to generate two different values, which is either 0 or 1, right? But this time, we need to generate x0, x1, x2, and so on. What we should do? We just do a very similar thing. We know that this U is standard uniform. It will take values within the interval from 0 to 1, right? And from 0 to 1, so we wish to design the random variable x, so something like this. With probability p0, it takes a value x0, right? And then what do we need to do? We just do what we did for Bernoulli. So first, we think of an interval of length p0. If this standard uniform takes a value within this interval, then this random variable x should take value x0. Right? So here, just for our convenience, we just put the first interval here from 0 to p0. Right? And we know that this x takes value x1 with probability p1, right? And then we need to think of the interval of length p1. We just let it be the next one, right? So the next one should be from p0 to p0 plus p1. So here, the length of that is just the p1. If this standard uniform takes a value within this interval, x should take x1, right? Straightforwardly. So next one, we need to think of an interval of length p2. So which means that it should be from p0 plus p1 to p0 plus p1 plus p2. If u takes the values here, then this x should take value x2, and so on, right? That's what we need to do for this one. The idea is pretty straightforward. However, so for this one, actually, we can further simplify this expression a little bit. How can we do that? So first, if we think of this p0, which is the probability that x take value x0, right? X take value x0, and this x0 is the smallest value this random variable may take. If it takes value x0, which is equal to this probability that it takes a value less than or equal to x0. Again, that is so because x0 is the smallest value it can take, right? So why bother to write in this way? Because this thing is just the CDF, cumulative distribution function at x0. So this thing is equal to capital F of x0. If we use this capital F for the CDF of x, right? So then, let's think of, that is this point, right? Let's think of the next point, which is P0 plus P1. P0 plus P1 is the probability that x takes either x0 or x1, right? In other words, it would be the probability that it takes a value less than or equal to x1. Again, why is so? Because x1 is the second smallest value this random variable would take. Right? And you see, at this point, you see this p0 plus p1 actually is f of x1. Right? And based on this argument, we can see that the next point, this one, essentially is just a f of x2, right? So then this expression would become to this thing. So x takes x0 if this is a standard uniform, takes a value between 0 and f of x0, right? Again, so this is the same as this. And this x takes x1 if u takes the value between f of x0 and f of x1, which is the same as this one, right? And so on. We just do something like this. According to this thing, actually, you can see x is equal to xk if u takes a value less than between f sub xk minus 1 and f alpha xk, right? So this is actually just a summary. This is a summary of this expression, right? So that's what we did for this, right? And then actually, so this is what do we need to do? We can check that. So in this case, what will be the probability that x takes the value xk? According to this expression, so this probability is simply equal to the probability that u takes a value between f of xk minus 1 and f of xk, right? And if u takes a value between, so those two numbers, because u is standard uniform between 0 and 1, right? So what is that probability? The probability is simply the length of that interval, so which is this guy minus this guy, right? Then what is this? And you can check that it is simply equal to pk. So this is the way. So we, this is the way so we design discrete. This is the way we generate discrete variables. And this method actually is called discrete inverse transform method. Why is that so? Because so this method actually is simply given by this expression. Here, you see that the CDF of x, this random variable x, is involved. Again, our purpose is to generate a discrete random variable whose cumulative distribution function is a given f, right? And the discrete inverse transform method just specifies that if you wish to achieve this, this is the way you need to do. You need to assign values to. This is the way how you assign probabilities for x, right? When u takes a value within this interval, then x should take this one. So in some sense, so this specifies a function. And as said, so this x should be understood as a function of u, right? This one actually specifies such a function. So the function takes a form like this. But how to understand that it is a function? What is a function? Then what is a function? The function is just like a pair of input and output.
As long as you know the input, the output must be fixed, then such a thing is called a function, right? So this, what is this one? As long as you know the value of u, you can determine the value of x. So in this sense, this x is a function of this surrounding variable u. So we can specify some h, which is a function. How to specify that? Just like that, or that, this way, right? So as long as you can realize, so this is just a, in this way, this x is a function of u, then actually, in some sense, so such a function is just an inverse function of this CDF. It is a generalized inverse function. Because later, so when we discuss continuous random variables, how to generate a continuous random variable, then you will see the exact inverse function of this F. But this one, this function, x is equal to h of u. This h is somewhat an inverse function of this F. So that's why it is called discrete inverse transform method. Right? It does not matter whether you know it's a generalized inverse function or something. But the point is, as long as you understand, so this expression, what does this mean, then it's fine. At least you know how to generate a discrete random variable. Right? So, I think I have two examples, but I'm not able to complete that today, so maybe I'll just leave it next time. Any questions?